So we've talked about the kind of the way that radar signals get transmitted and reflected back, and the fact that the combination of several things on the ground will result in the final amplitude and phase measurements that you make at the antenna. So why radar for remote sensing? Well, there's a number of reasons that we use it. One of the biggest benefits of radar is that it is insensitive to clouds. It works day or night, it doesn't require solar illumination, and it penetrates the atmosphere quite well. Now, there is some delays in the radar signal that result from traveling through the atmosphere. We'll talk about those in a different video. But for the most part, radar is extremely useful in terms of its versatility, in that it can image through a storm, it can image at night, it can image basically any time, day or night, all the time. And it's also sensitive. The wavelengths of radar turn out to be sensitive to objects of the sizes that we're generally interested in learning about. So radar waves or radar images are primarily sensitive. They interact primarily with objects of the same size as the wavelength of the radar. And I've got an image here which shows just different wavelengths. This is actually showing the transmission percentage through the Earth's atmosphere. You can see visible light here. Visible light is visible because it's transmitted quite well through the atmosphere. But as you get to different wavelengths, there's a lot of energy that's lost as you go through the atmosphere, and that's a good thing because we're protected from certain types of harmful radiation. But you can see here in the kind of 1 to 80 centimeters range is the radar wavelength in centimeters. So these are microwaves, and you can see there are some absorption bands here, but by the time you get up to around 4 centimeters or so of wavelength, you have basically 100% transmission of radar waves through the atmosphere. And so this is the bands that we're using. X band is here, C band is sitting right here at about 5 centimeters, L band is up here at around 20 to 25 centimeters. So these are different bands that are used for radar, and these bands are more or less transmitted right through the atmosphere quite well. Right, so these wavelengths of kind of 1 to 20 centimeters, this is the wavelength of plants and leaves, and this turns out to be a very valuable tool for studying vegetation, ocean waves in some cases, some types of waves, snow depth. Radar is used for all these things. So radar is divided into these different bands, as I've already mentioned. You've got L band, S band, C band, and X band are the primary radar bands that are used, X band being the highest frequency, shortest wavelength, and L band being the longest wavelength, lowest frequency. And again, since waves interact most strongly with scattering objects with the sizes on the order of their wavelength, you can actually use multiple wavelength radars to learn more about a surface. So a longer wavelength L band radar, for example, is going to interact differently with a vegetated area than a C band. And in fact, C band radar will definitely decorrelate over time because of vegetation growth and things like that. So just some general things to be aware of about radar. And again, I've already mentioned this briefly, but just to reiterate, if you have a very smooth surface, that's going to tend to reflect all the radiation away from the sensor, whereas a very rough surface will scatter energy in all directions, and so your sensor will actually pick up the most backscattered radiation from a very rough surface in comparison with a very smooth surface. That can be a little confusing, I know. It's just because it's acting like a mirror. If you have a very flat surface, that radiation, the incident radiation from the satellite or from the airplane, reflects off in the other direction and doesn't come back. All right, so I'm going to stop there and I will see you in the next video.